inches, but I thought it should be done. And so I told someone the title of this week's message, and they went, which is not a tremendous response when you tell somebody something that you're kind of like into. You know what I mean? I really love you. doesn't really work that well. But I titled this message, Jesus Has Unrealistic Expectations. Today, today, if you have questions during the teaching time, please feel free to raise your hand and ask. I want to make sure that nobody leaves with questions in their mind, confused or anything like that. I want to start with a question to you, though. Now, usually I'm super funny and great at this, but this is one of those weeks where you're going to be super mad at me, maybe, when you leave. So, let me start with the question. What is your view of God? Does God exist to serve you, or do you exist to serve him? Now, you may not have ever said, God exists to serve me, but I want you to hold a mirror up to yourself. Do I live as though God exists to serve me? That's the question that I want us to wrestle with. We sometimes think it's weird when someone takes God's word seriously. Call them crazy or fanatical or just straight weird, I don't know, whatever you call them. We sometimes think that it's weird for someone to hear God's word and do what God says. And I think what it comes down to is the answer to that question. Who is God in that person's life? Does he exist to serve them, or do they exist to serve him? At LCC, this church, Liverpool Christian Church, we want our church to be a God-centered church. We want to operate with a God-centered theology. Theology is just the study of God, right? So the putting of our lives into who God is. We want a God-centered theology here. We do not want a man-centered theology at this church. There is no such thing as a man-centered theology in the Bible. It is a God-centered Bible, and we want to operate that way. In a God-centered theology, everything revolves around God, and in a man-centered theology, everything revolves around me. Now, I believe that a God-centered theology answers these kind of questions. Well, this thing happened in my life, or I got hurt by this person, or this person died, and if there was a God, he would not have let these things happen. And I say that's true. There may not be a God whose existence is to serve you and revolve around you, but there may exist a God who everything is supposed to revolve around. See, we have a very temporary, very fleshly, very earthly, very worldly perspective in a man-centered theology. But in a God-centered theology, we say, I want whatever you want. Jesus encouraged us to pray, not my will, but yours be done. Not my way, but your way. And this says, God, I want what you want. In a God-centered theology, everything centers around God. And so there's times when you'll read the Bible and you'll have trouble with a passage, and you'll say, this thing isn't true, or that thing isn't true. And I believe that when we read the Bible and we have so much trouble with the passage that we can deny Jesus and what he says because of that, it's not because we've elevated him into a position of God. It's because we've elevated ourselves into a position of God and put him under us, not the other way around. And so in a God-centered theology, God is first. Everything was made for God. Everything on this earth was made for him. Look at this passage in Colossians chapter 1. I pointed back there. You don't have to look back there. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and what?
For him.
For him. All things have been created for him. I wanna dig at you a little bit. Can I dig a little bit right here? Look at what he says in verse 16. In him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. Your president was put there by Jesus. So was Barack Obama. So was Bill Clinton. So was George Bush. So, as far back as I can remember, all of them. All of those people are put there for God's purpose. So when you on your social media, how much Trump sucks and this thing or that, or you're backing Trump about how all the children should die, or whatever stupid thing is happening on social media, we have to understand. We have to understand. Whoever is in charge of us on this earth was put there by Jesus.
Amen.
We do not have to like it. But we do have to be obedient to Jesus. Everything on this earth was made for Jesus. We understand this. We need to know this, that we revolve around him. So rather than saying to God, why don't you give me what I want? We should pray that our will would bend to his will. Sometimes we read the Bible and we disagree with God. Today will be no different. We can read the Bible and disagree with God. In fact, I think it's okay to do that. But when we read the Bible and disagree with God, we have to make a decision. Will our disagreement lead to disobedience, or will it lead to obedience? You don't have to agree with what God says to be obedient to what God says. My little brother and I used to fight and wrestle, and I love him. I would never fight him now, because he went off to like do Marine stuff, and you don't mess with those guys. They know how to put you on the ground. But we were fighting wrestling stuff, and one time I had him down, and I was going to punch him, and he said, I'm not scared of you. And I said, you don't have to be scared for me to punch you in the face. And then I punched him in the face. And so he got me back years later when he came back from boot camp, and he said, hey, I want to show you something. Put your arm behind your back. I was like, no, I'm not doing that. He's stupid. I'm not doing that. He's like, come on. I promise it won't hurt. So I made the move like this to start putting my arm behind my back. And the next thing I know, I was on the floor like this. And he was making me say uncle in front of my mom and dad, my wife, and my children. So he got me back later. Anyway. But we don't have to agree with God's word to obey it. You ever had a little kid tell you that you're doing something wrong and how ridiculous that sounds? And so if you think about eternal God, existed way before us, existed long before this earth was here, how ridiculous must it sound to him when a 20-something, 30-something, 40-something, 50-something, 60-something person says, God, you're doing it wrong. He is eternal. These 2-year-olds, 3-year-olds, 4-year-olds that try and tell us that we're doing something wrong, it's so cute, isn't it? Up to a point, right? And then you want to pick them up and just chuck them out the back yard. You know what I'm saying? Like, it gets super annoying. If we disagree with God, that's okay. But if we disagree with God and we retain our own opinion, God is not God in my life, I am. And I would suggest to you that that's a dangerous place to be. So today's passage is not a passage that is meant to serve us, but rather meant for us to disagree with and do anyway. It's a passage that's meant to make Jesus famous in this world. And so I ask myself when I'm writing this, what does Jesus want? What in the world does Jesus want? And I think the answer is very simple. Jesus wants disciples. Jesus wants disciples. A disciple is someone who hears what the teacher said and then does what the teacher said. Jesus wants us to be his disciples. He wants us to hear the things that he says and do the things that he says. So I started thinking, what does a modern day disciple look like? Because obviously we're not wearing robes and sandals and wandering around the Middle East. So So what does a modern day disciple look like? Well, a modern day disciple might sell everything they have and give their money to the poor, or sell something that they have, or make a sacrifice and give that to the poor. A modern day disciple considers what Jesus thinks with all of their activities, not some of them. A modern day disciple might give 10% of their income or more to their local church and be active in service outside of their church, not compartmentalizing your Christianity to 2021 Cold Springs Road. That's what a disciple does. I think another thing a disciple does is take God's word seriously and then change their life to match what they've learned from God's word. Whenever I do premarital counseling, I always encourage people to stop having sex or to not have any more sex until they're married. And I don't care if it's a week away or a year away. That's one of the first things that I talk about when I do premarital counseling. Some of these freaks have actually said okay and stopped and been obedient to Jesus. They've moved into other bedrooms. Sometimes they've moved out of their house and in with a relative. You know, it smells like Fritos. You know what I mean? But that's the sacrifice that they make so that they can be obedient to Jesus. A modern day disciple hears what God says and wants to do that. I've even had people get married in my office because their flesh is too much and they can't wait. Dude, I get it. I'm not going to say it anymore. I'm going to get in so much trouble. A modern day disciple prays with their families. They might raise their hand and worship. They might say yes to Jesus when it's uncomfortable or inconvenient. A modern day disciple listens to the Holy Spirit when they're prompted. I want to give you an example of that. And can I tell you a story about me and not take it as a brag? Like, I don't know that I'm a braggart. I don't think I'm that guy. So can I just tell you a story about a thing that happened and you not, like, think I'm the greatest? I mean, you already know that. Last week, when Aaron and Randy were standing up here talking about Financial Peace University, I was sitting over there, and my wife was sitting up here. And while I was sitting over there, I felt a very clear sense of the Holy Spirit saying, you should send someone to Financial Peace. And I was like, yeah, that's cool. Like, in my mind, yeah, I'll do that. It's pretty sweet. Well, literally simultaneously, the Holy Spirit is speaking to my wife, saying, hey, you guys should send someone to Financial Peace. And so we didn't, like, get into cahoots about it or anything. And then after church, Shannon came up to me and said, hey, we should send somebody to Financial Peace. I was like, oh, my God, I can't believe that this thing just happened. And this is what I mean by listening to the Holy Spirit, right? You get this sense in your heart. You feel this urge, this thing. And you do that. That's what a modern-day disciple does. They're available to whatever leadings they've received from God. They might disagree with God and do what he asks anyway. A modern-day disciple hears and does. And so today, let us not hear God's word and do nothing. Let us not hear God's word and do nothing. Guys, turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5. And if you have a row Bible, it's page 787. And you can also follow along in the YouVersion Bible app. Matthew chapter 5, verse 43. Now, all of that was the introduction for the sermon. So I don't usually count that toward my preaching time, because it's just fluff, you know. So we're going to be another 40, 45, 2 hours. Matthew chapter 5, verses 43 through 48, page 787. You guys got it? This is Jesus, and I know that because it's in red. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, What are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? And here's the unrealistic expectation. Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. I want to go through that one more time. All right? You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. This is an unfortunate passage if you believe that God exists to serve your purposes. If I was living in a man-centered theology, I would say, a rip, trash, ball, gone. I wouldn't listen to this passage at all. It seems ridiculous to me. I would totally ignore this passage and move on to something else. Who really wants to love on or take care of people who hate them? None of us, like, wake up in the morning going, can't wait to see all those people that I don't like or that don't like me. Nobody wakes up like that. And I think that it comes down to perspective. Okay, so in a God-centered theology, he's on top, we listen to what he says, we understand that when people die on this earth, they're diving in the grave, people die on this earth, that we go into an afterlife where there's a heaven or a hell, an eternity with or without Jesus. We understand that in a God-centered theology. In a man-centered theology, I got to get mine! And I want the most I can get, the most I can grab, the most I can handle, the most that I can hold on to, and screw you if you try and block me. That's man-centered theology. We don't want that in our life. We want God-centered theology. And so I think what it comes down to is perspective. How can I love my enemies? How can I do this thing that Jesus asked me to? It's because of perspective. In a God-centered theology, we begin to grasp the eternal, and then therefore all of the problems, the worldly things, the troubles that we go through, the fights, the things that happen between us and other people, begin to seem so small if you look at them through eternal eyes or with an eternal perspective. In a man-centered philosophy, man-centered theology, I'm just going to focus on myself, and if you try and mess me over, I'm going to try and mess you over because I'm going to do everything I can for myself. But God-centered theology is completely different. See, if we have this God-centered theology, everything is in a broader perspective. So the squabble, the hurt, the thing that somebody said, whatever those things might be, they pale in comparison to eternity. And if you stand back and you think about it, that whole, like, he said that I was this thing, and she said that I was this thing, and this thing happened, and this stuff happened. It seems very childish, right? It seems very petty, very childish. It doesn't last. It's not eternal. It's ridiculous when you have a God-centered perspective to think that anything on this world is worth hating someone over. So, four quick things. Jesus wants disciples who love their enemies. Jesus wants disciples who love their enemies. Love is defined as, we say it in this church, love is thinking the best and doing the best to the point of self-sacrifice. Thinking the best and doing the best to the point of self-sacrifice. I mean, if I say that I love somebody, or if I want to show Jesus' love to somebody, that it's probably going to cost me something. Some time, some effort, some energy, whatever that thing might be. And Jesus wants us not just to love those who are agreeable, but to love our enemies, meaning that we should think the best and do the best to the point of self-sacrifice for someone who might not ever do that for you. Is that Jesus calling? Jesus texted somebody in first service. So what is a modern-day enemy? A I started trying to think about that. What is a modern day enemy? I mean, certainly we have threats from the outside. We have terrorism, things like that to deal with, school shootings, all of that sort of stuff. But on a daily basis, most of us aren't dealing with things that are that dramatic. So what is your modern day enemy? And I started thinking that maybe it's that annoying neighbor who, like, when they blow their leaves, half of them are in your yard, you know what I mean? That, I mean, that's a modern day enemy, because you can brew on that and stew on that. Maybe it's your an annoying coworker, an annoying boss, or somebody in your life like that that you might classify as an enemy. Maybe someone didn't respond positively to your social media post, and now they're your enemy, right? Now, that sounds so stupid, but I'm saying it right here. But wait till you get a nasty comment on a social media post. You go, unfriend that, fuck that back. Right? They become our enemy, right? So how does it flesh out? How do you love your enemy? Well, I'll give you just one example. You see your enemy, you see the person who wronged you, the annoying person, the person who hurt you, the leaf-blowing neighbor. You see them somewhere with a flat tire, rather than like driving by and looking for a puddle to splash them with, you stop and you help them. That's loving your enemy. That's doing something. That's serving your enemy. See, love is action. Love is not words. And so I think Jesus is telling us to sacrifice ourselves for our enemies. And in a man-centered theology, you would never do that. You would never do that. But we want a God-centered theology. Jesus wants disciples who love their enemies. Jesus wants us to pray for those who persecute us. Jesus wants disciples who pray for those who persecute them. Have you ever done this? Have you ever prayed for someone who is verbally or emotionally or social medially attacking you? Because it's a totally different perspective than diving into the pettiness and childishness of that argument or that thing. Pray for them. Pray for those who persecute you. Here's what you just close your eyes. By the way, I need to clarify this. Pray for them, not at them. There's a big difference there. Don't pray at people. You don't have that authority. None of us have that authority to pray at people. So we close our eyes, we pray, and we ask God to bless them, to open doors so that they can accept Jesus. I always tell people, when somebody's annoying you or bothering you, you should pray for them out loud and by name. There's something about doing that. And the point of all of that is so that you can be reconciled to them. So that you might be able to introduce them, bring them closer to Jesus. It's not so that they'll get theirs or so that they'll fall off a bridge or whatever. It's so that there can be reconciliation in that, and so that that could happen through you when you pray for someone who persecutes you. Jesus also wants disciples who greet those who aren't lovable. Now, this seems easy. In the four things that we're going to have on this list, you're going to think, maybe, that's the easiest one. I'll check that off. I'm going to go on my way. I'm going to do that. But if you understand anything about ancient greetings, you know that this could be one of the harder, more involved things that I'm asking you to do today. Jesus wants disciples who greet those who are lovable. Now, this is how we greet each other now. So, and then, no, you don't care how they're doing, because you're going to keep going where you're going. When Jesus wants us to greet those who are unlovable, he's saying, I want you involved in people's lives. Unlovable people's lives. It's easy to be involved in people's lives who are lovable. Everybody wants to do that. But Jesus is saying, be involved in the lives of people who are unlovable. And I think what Jesus is asking us to do here is to develop community with people. And in a community, there's all different kinds of people. And I think Jesus wants us to take this greeting thing to a level that is so far beyond what we do now. To be involved in someone's life. To say, how are you doing? And then wait for a real response. That's what we should be doing as disciples. Lastly, Jesus says that he wants disciples who are perfect. That sucks. I read that and I go, dude, have you met me? Like, what is going on here? Jesus wants disciples who are perfect. Now, let's take that in context. Context is everything in this passage. Jesus wants disciples who are perfect, and I think it's referring to one specific thing, loving your enemies. Jesus wants disciples who are perfect at loving their enemies. Now, in no way is Jesus saying that he expects you to be perfect, sin-free. There's no expectation of that. If there were an expectation of that, then we would not need the grace, love, mercy, and forgiveness that Jesus offered when he went to the cross for us. You understand what I'm saying? So it has to be a context thing. In the context of this passage, Jesus wants us to be perfect at loving other people. I like checklists, right? I think most men do. I've never been a woman, so I don't know. But me, I love checklists because I like to, at the end of the day, see what I've done and things like that. I like to get that done. There's not a lot of checklists in the Bible, right? There's not a lot of do this and then do whatever you want, okay? Here's something for us to strive for, checklist fashion, all right? Being perfect at loving other people. If there's anything that you can strive for this week, it's being perfect at loving other people. And then Friday or Saturday, ask yourself, how did I do? Like, give yourself a number, like, between 1 and 10. And, be gracious to yourself, right? But check it. Check it and see where you are. How are you doing at being perfect at loving other people? You can ask yourself that on Friday or Saturday this week. Can I try again? Do I need to apologize to anyone? Because ultimately, I think that as disciples, we need to rise above the pettiness of this world. We need to exemplify Jesus in our relationships. We need to live each day with a God-centered perspective. People have told me that they don't want to have anything to do with the Bible because it's just a bunch of do's and don'ts. And then they complain because there's not a list of something to do. What is wrong with people? I don't know. I want you to read this passage with me. It's going to be on the screen. I want you to just take everything out of your hand, put everything down, and I want us to just take this passage in and read this together. Like, follow along with me as I read. It's from Romans chapter 12, verses 9 and 10. I want to invite the band to come back up. And what I want to say about this passage is that Jesus kind of spoke in a general thing there. Be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Be perfect at loving people. Well, Paul, in Romans chapter 9, or Romans chapter 12, takes it to the next level, and he gives us a list of things to do. Now, I will say this. If we only had these verses, and we only ever did these verses, and we really were committed to them, the world would know Jesus far greater than the world knows Jesus now. Okay? So, I want us to look at this, and I want us to think about this as a checklist, as a starting point for us to be able to be perfect at loving our enemies, okay? Romans 12, 9. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. That's how you keep your spiritual fervor. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible. The reason he says if is because it won't always be. But if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, "It is mine to avenge. I will repay," says the Lord. On the contrary, If your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Jesus wants disciples. Jesus wants us to be his disciples, to hear what he says and to do what he says. And if you take what we learned today from Matthew,